Basically, I have divided the entire conversation into two parts, and the first part is basically will be questions related to COVID and its effect on the entire education landscape. And then the second set of questions would be basically on national education policy, because these are the two things which have been taking place in the past few months. So my first question to begin with is like during entire like because of this COVID, schools have shut down, and it has affected all the students, but primarily government school children. So how do you foresee like what will be the large scale effect on the learning of these children in years to come? And do you see any positives of this entire lockdown on the system?
Few things are quite evident that it's difficult for children to stay at home. Surely, they are missing their friends. Many of them might be missing their teachers. A large number of them are likely to be facing difficult situations. A parent may be without a job, and of course, there are a large number of migrant groups who have just gone back. So yes, children are affected. But at the same time, the thing is that children are natural learners. So it is not as, we are concerned a lot about their learning, but what we mean is their scholastic textbook-oriented learning less? But there might be other kind of learning that is going up a lot more. They may be learning to do more things at home. They may be managing more in their neighborhood or with their friends. Some of them, out of sheer boredom will start picking up and reading things which they would not have done otherwise. So children are, in any case, many of them would have learned to use technology in a way that they did not use before. They would be hearing a lot that is going on around them. They'll be figuring out many things and how to manage, how to deal with this situation. There is going to be a definite traumatic effect on many of them. There will be socio-emotional issues coming up. But at the same time, being with themselves, being with each other, and in the circumstances at home or in the neighborhood, they're also learning a lot of other things. So that's not to be discounted. For example, let's say there was a generation that went through the time of World War or through the time of famine. It's true that they missed out on certain things, but then they kind of got other things which the rest of the people who never went through that never got. So it's you have to see it in that sense. So yes, there are issues there also, but there are going to be no serious effects on the education system per se. The big effect is going to be in terms of two things at least. One is that because of private schools shutting down, which is already happening in a big way, they cannot sustain themselves given the fact that they are not getting fees, and parents are also not able to pay the fees even if they wanted to. So private schools are shutting down in a big way. Where will these children go? They will eventually end up going to the government school system. The other thing that is going to happen is that as migrants have returned, even if the migrants are re-returning to the cities, the children are still remaining in the village. That is the case quite commonly to be seen. So what is happening is there is a new set of population in a small space. So in a place where a school had space for 100 children, there will be some more children coming in from private schools, and there will be some children who are migrant returnees, and they are all from different states. So as a result, there is going to be a change in the student population, and diversity will become different than it used to be. So that is going to be one issue. There will be more children who than used to be the case, so that teacher-student ratio is going to be an issue. And in addition to this, even along with all this, there is going to be a dropout in certain categories of students. So boys in secondary education, girls at multiple levels, will be affected, especially if livelihoods are at stake. Then the first thing that happens is when your regular routine is not possible for parents, girls are the ones who have to step in and take care of home, and there'll be other issues as well. So overall, if you look at it, some children are going to drop out, and there is going to be a change in the student population, and not to mention the large gap of so many months, maybe as much as a year, which is going to be an issue. And when they come back, the thing is that everybody will be concerned about catching up. But the real issue is to relate, to reconnect with children, to establish an emotional bond, and because their need will be probably a lot more emotional and social rather than intellectual or cognitive. So it is very possible that we might mistakenly be focusing on pressurizing children to learn instead of actually helping them to re-enter education in a different mode. So that's the sort of broad scenario that I would say.
Thank you, sir. And exactly, like the major issue, what I also feel like when once the school starts, would be not like the focus should not be on basically to start teaching what has been lost, but actually to move like tell children, like take care of their social needs and like bring the students to the pace of it, like okay, whatever has been done is done, now let's move ahead of that. So yeah, so sir, like because of this entire thing, our classrooms have moved to digital, our classrooms have moved digitally, and because of that, what has happened is like a lot of digital content has been flooded in the market. On internet you can see a lot of digital content coming up and on. What do you see, like what are the challenges you see because of this entire digital content which is coming on internet?
So one or two small things, you know, one is that it's good to see that in many places with government teachers as well, they're trying other means to reach children other than digital as well. So there are community places where teachers are meeting children. I know that in some places a kind of emergency relief kit, an educational relief kit is being distributed, you know, with stationery, things to read, things to do, which is physical in form. In some places, newspapers have started publishing things which children can do at home. That you must be knowing that in many places, the loudspeaker is being used. Yes. You know, so on. So there are different, and obviously it's, maybe there's not much point in saying it, but all this innovation is being done by government teachers and not by private school teachers.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So after all these years, everybody has been running down private government schools, and now we find that the government schools are the ones who are actually making the effort. So I think there's a need for a bit of revision of views on this front. In terms of the tech challenges, so that, technology has been around for a very long time, but it's not made a disruption in education. And the reason it doesn't make a disruption in education is because it repeats all the mistakes of education. The main mistake that is made in education systems is the notion that unless I explain and unless I teach children, they are not going to learn. I have to give all the answers to children. And that is the reason why, you know, our learning levels are also very low. What teachers really have to do is to create a situation where children want to engage with something. They work a bit on their own. They are supported by teachers rather than given all the answers to by the teachers. So if that question is not in children's mind, if there is no curiosity in children's mind, but somebody is providing an answer to it, nobody is going to pay attention to it. So this is somewhat like the kind of thing which technology also ends up doing. It provides a situation where all the answers are contained in the technology. But actually what should be contained in technology are starting points, exploration points, suggestions of things to do, but not the answers themselves. And there's a reason for this, you know. The reason is that all of us who are over the age of 20, when we were young, we grew up in what we may call an information scarce society. So when not everybody had any information, so a person who had a lot of information was seen as very knowledgeable. Now, it became therefore the understanding that having a lot of information is like having knowledge. Being able to reproduce information at will shows you are a very intelligent person, and that's how exams were, assessments were, to a great extent, many of these tests, entrance tests and other things were also like that. So when a lot of ed tech has been made, what it has done is it has essentially tried to align itself with this model of thinking, this model of knowledge. And much of the stuff we see in market is essentially like that. It is answers to questions nobody is asking. And I call that spam. What is spam? It is essentially answers to question nobody is asking. So in reality, what should be available is some curious, interesting thing. For example, you know, when you pedal a cycle forward, the wheel moves forward, but when you pedal it backward, it doesn't. So why does that happen? I would give that question through tech and leave children to find out and to share their answers rather than to give them a correct answer. The problem is with this correct answer mindset and mentality. So to me, one big challenge is this. Second is that people are not able to make out what is okay and what is not okay. So for example, in mathematics, there are any number of things which essentially in one way or the other get children to memorize multiplication table without focusing on understanding them. Now that's a counterproductive way to teach mathematics. So the inability to decide what is appropriate, what is not, the lack of discrimination on part of the user is the second thing. And obviously, you know, a lot of material is being pushed by vendors. I mean, that's a generic term that I will use. These are people whose primary interest is technology and not children or not education. So as a result, they have a view on what education is. It is not driven by educators or their needs. And educators themselves to have a very limited view of a lot of things because of their own background. So what is going to happen is that you will have literally billions of pieces, but very few will be really worthwhile and not everybody will get to them. And the last thing in this is that this part has not yet been totally worked out yet, which is what is the exact balance or mix between the human part and the tech part. So if you analyze any curriculum, some things are done much better by technology and some things are done better by face-to-face. But which is which? And when you create anything, how do you balance out between the two? When should the teacher get out of the way? When should technology be reduced? This part has not been understood. So everything mindlessly in a way is being just without discrimination is being dumped onto technology. So all this, I am not convinced is very helpful. It is not really making a lot of difference. Many people make a lot of claims. Every tech company says it is revolutionizing education, but education is refusing to be revolutionized. And you see that a lot of it is test oriented. And people even include assessment, but say that the idea is to personalize learning. In order to personalize learning, essentially, it's not enough only to personalize in terms of the level of the student. So most of the personalization, adaptive as they call it, is about the level and the pace of the learner. But actually, there are other elements. For example, are you a rural child or an urban child? Are you a boy or a girl? And there may be variations according to that. What kind of things do you have at home that you can do things with? So on. So, you know, we need where we have to do adaptation, it has to be done with a lot more profiling of the student. So yes, there are a lot of challenges. Simply, you know, a lot of activity is not equal to a lot of movement forward. It's like they say in army and NCC, kadam tal, you know, marching on the spot. Yeah. So we are very active, but are we moving forward? I can't say.
Thank you, sir. So, sir, like my a follow-up question to this is basically like, as you also mentioned in the later part, that it has to be noticed, like, and it has to be observed that where the children are from. Either they are from the rural background or the urban background, and what have the resources and all. So because of this entire situation which has been created, a lot of talks has been on the digital divide as well. And because of that, how do you think that being cognizant of the fact that, yes, the digital divide exists, and how can we still be effective? How can we make our digital pedagogy effective?
Right. The first point that I want to mention is that the digital divide is only one divide among other divides. And some divides are well known and some are not recognized at all. So, you know, like we everybody knows that some there is also a paper divide.
Paper divide?
Children, yes. For example, children from middle class home, they may read as many as 4,000 pages of material in 1 year. But children from less privileged background may not get 400 pages also.
Okay.
So somehow we have not talked about that divide very much. But we need to look at all of this in one go. There is another very big divide, which is that what is considered worth knowing. So for example, a tribal child knows a lot about plants. You can try this out. You ask an MSc botany student, how many trees this person can name which have thorns. You will usually find that a tribal child who is in class 2 names more trees like that than this MSc botany person.
That's true.
You look at a rural child, he will look at a pile of rope and he will tell you whether it is long enough to reach water in the well. But an urban child cannot do that. So on. I mean, I can give a long list of things of this kind. For example, urban children have not taken care of animals the way rural children have taken care of animals. So they know a lot about animals, which is in a way also related to the kind of things we try to teach them in biology, for example. So, you know, the point I'm making is that we see the divide in one way. We do not see it the other way. A friend of mine who works with international schools, those IB schools, where children come from very privileged background. He works on science teaching and he finds that they are unable to, for example, thread a needle.
Okay.
They are unable to use a pair of scissors effectively. So they can't work with their hands, and science is a lot about setting up experiments using your hand. So basically their science learning is hampered a lot. Whereas a rural child can do all of this very easily. So that child is advantaged in certain ways. So, you know, we do not recognize this at all. And that is a problem, because if we were to recognize it, then in our classroom processes and even in our digital divide, even in our digital processes, we could actually bring in the knowledge that these children bring to the fore by asking the kind of things that they are more familiar with. So, for example, if I have to talk about heat, I will talk about, you know, in a bullock cart wheel, what is the way of putting that metal rim on it? An urban child will be totally lost in this. But my rural child will say, you take the rim and heat it, it will expand, then you put it, wait for it, it will cool down, it will stick. Right. So then I will say, okay, so we know metal expands. What is so? What I'm driving at is, if we start with the knowledge that these children bring, then many things which we are using in our technology will be much more accessible. Now, the other issue is, how do I get it to these kids? So one is, I have repeatedly found that making use of low-end technology is extremely helpful.
Okay.
When we make high-end technology where you can have bells and whistles, you know, videos and animation and everything can be done, the temptation is that we will provide all the learning. But when I go low-tech, then I can do many other things. For example, an exercise which we even did with the Sterlite teachers was, this is what a verb is. Can you go and take a photo of a verb? So yep. It can be done on a low-end phone. It does not need a smartphone necessarily. Every low-end phone also has a stopwatch. I can do a lot of things with a stopwatch. I can do a lot of things with a calendar. So, and I can send a free SMS text to that phone every day or thrice a day if I need to. I can do a lot of things with those. So one part is that, if we get away from the mindset that technology works only if all the answers are contained there, then the desired divide will remain, and also it will disadvantage children from better off families, because all the time they will be dependent on the device. Eventually, after 30, 40 years, you will find that children who have had to learn on their own in real life or from other things, they will start going ahead on many parameters. So it would be better to re-examine how we use technology and see it as providing openings and triggers. So I will send a message to all the children saying that, can you just document exactly how many liters of water your whole family used today?
Okay.
Text me the answer tomorrow. I can do a lot more learning because out of just this, learning is not going to happen when I do it. Learning is going to happen when I trigger it and they do it. So our problem is that we are not able to understand how to trigger things off. If we could do that, then it might be better. Lastly, I would say that it is not necessary that there has to be one device per child. There are a lot of devices floating around. So if, for example, a panchayat member has an app, he calls five children, he shows them a 5-minute video, and at the end of the video says, these are the three things you have to do today. You have to make one drawing, you have to make one table, and this is what it looks like. And let me know tomorrow. And it goes away. So what happens is the panchayat guy goes off with that phone, but children have something to do for today. So there are so many different ways that we can use very limited technology far more effectively than we are doing. Our problem is we have too much of technology where we have it and we think we have got all the solutions inside. In fact, there's data to indicate that in countries like the US, where there are places where there are 2 to 2.5 computers per child inside a classroom, children don't like using those computers at all. They prefer to use their own device when they come out of it. The reason is that on their own device, they set the agenda.
Yep.
So that's what we have to do. We have to make an empowering use of technology.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I would now like to move on the questions related to the education policy. In this education policy, a lot of focus has been on digital pedagogy and basically learners acquiring the critical thinking abilities. What are some of the challenges that you foresee in achieving these goals in the longer run?
Right. So on the digital pedagogy side, high quality digital pedagogy has a few expectations or requirements. One is that it should generate genuine engagement. By genuine engagement, I mean not just playing a game, but wanting to stick with something and work at it and solve it. So it has to do that. Secondly, it has to enable productive collaboration among different learners. And thirdly, it has to adapt itself to the learner. Now, in each of these, there are the challenges. The challenges are, less practical and more conceptual, in my view. Overall, our system has not been built around genuinely engaging students. The idea is that it is children's job to learn. It's a privilege. They are getting a chance to come to school and they better pay attention and they listen to us. So the whole model is based on giving knowledge. It is based on a favor being done. It's a privilege. Now, education is a right. So that shift has to reflect in pedagogy and in our use of technology as well. How do children actually become interested in the learning process per se, with or without technology, is a question to be sorted out. Though we have a lot of idea of how to do it, we are not able to make it happen on scale. One reason we can't make it happen on scale is that those who communicate with teachers are themselves not able to practice these things.
Absolutely.
So there is, I will call a problem of a pedagogy mindset. Inside the classroom, we still see teachers teaching all the children the same thing at the same time, which means that adaptive learning process, which is very easy to do without technology, is not being done at all. So doing it with technology is a little way off at the moment. Another part with the, we are not seeing collaborative learning happening in the classroom as well. So one reason why, this doesn't happen is because there's what I will call a tech mindset issue. The tech mindset issue is that we want to see tech in the form of how we used to teach before. We have to see what tech can do, which we could not do. For example, tech can make a child practice something again and again without getting impatient. It can present the kind of visualization we can't do. So there are certain things tech can do, but there are things it can't do, as I mentioned. So, and the other part is, the big thing that tech can do is, it can give you just-in-time information. It can tell you what needs to be done at a particular time with a particular student. Which means that in a classroom, a teacher can understand my children have different needs and I have to use different things for them. But here, the problem we run across is the inability to or the unwillingness to engage with data. So there's an issue of data-mindedness. You know that when we look at assessment data, for example, we take very general, generic sort of views. We do not look at in a very detailed manner about which learner needs what help or which part of my input did not work very well. Now, if I bring in technology, will that really work? That will work only if we are willing to logically analyze things, see that our job is to fulfill the right of each child to learn in an engaged manner, in a meaningful, relevant way, and then apply technology. So those are bigger problems. The kind of technology that can do this does exist. But will it be used that way? We are not sure. The tendency in everybody is to look for ready-made inputs. If you look at, for example, what WhatsApp can do brilliantly many, many things. But it is also doing a lot of other things which are leading to prejudice, violence, and so on. What technology often does is that it amplifies the tendencies that people have. If you look at the work of Kentaro Toyama, who implemented more than 50 projects in India and found repeatedly that it increases the gaps between the haves and have-nots and amplifies tendencies, especially negative tendencies. So when we take technology, if we are not careful, what it will do is it will amplify the current pedagogical tendencies, the nature of relationships or the limitations in the nature of relationships people have about children or views about children, or that the views that trainers have about teachers or the views that teachers have about themselves. So that, to me, that is a very big challenge. The challenge is not technology per se. Technology will only do what we ask it to do. But are we asking it to do the right thing? Do we know what is the right thing? And after knowing what is the right thing, are we doing it? Like everybody knows they should wear masks, but they don't wear it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's the danger that we have with technology, because the thing is, with face-to-face, you could go wrong up only in a limited manner. But with technology, you can go wrong very fast in a very big manner.
Absolutely.
So like earlier, I could give a bad lecture to 50 people only. Now I can give the bad thing to 50,000 people in one go. So to me, those are the big challenges as far as technology is concerned. On critical thinking, again, the thing is, it's good that as a country, we are talking about it at all. That's nice to know. And the reason is, as I mentioned, till now, when we were an information scarce world, you could manage very well with just having information. But now with a mobile phone, anybody can get any information. So having that is not enough. What do you need? You need a lot more than that. You need to know what is the right question. What is the question worth asking? What is the way to know whether a question's answer is appropriate or not? Whether the question applies here or not? What are the choices I have to make? How am I making the right choice? Now, this is the kind of thing that calls for, critical literacy, which is about going beyond information and critical thinking abilities. It is being able to, for example, distinguish between a fact and an opinion and to know when a fact is valid and when an opinion is valid. Now, in future, the world will belong to people who can do all of this, and just having a lot of information is a kind of a pointless thing. You don't even need to know a lot, but you need to know how to do what you're doing with that. So in that sense, the policymakers' emphasis on this is absolutely on solid ground to be appreciated. And I'm glad it is there. The difficulty is, as I said, in making the change from what exists right now. What exists is a manifestation of a command and control situation. Mm. And that situation is not only in education, it is everywhere. Okay. It's been there from the Vedic times, I would say. Let me make a controversial statement. You know, in the Vedas insist that manan, which is reflection, is above shravan, which is listening. All right.
Yeah.
So the Vedas valued reflection. But at the same time, you know, somebody came along and said, Gurur Brahma. Whatever the guru says is the voice of Brahma. Do you know who said it? The gurus themselves said it.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's
yeah.
the oldest marketing ploy in the world. Huh? And it is an example of how the Vedic education policy, the new Vedic education policy, was upturned by the gurus of that time. And so even though the scriptures asked reflection to be foregrounded, but in our history, simply gyan dan, listening to the teacher, memorizing, repeating what the teacher said, not questioning the teacher, is what has got emphasized. In families, you have to respect your elders. In organizations, you have to respect the boss. Even the words that are used, a superior officer, my inferior, is what people actually say. So, and of course, the education system is like it. Society is like that. So, you know, like, for example, when you ask a question like, this is a critical thinking question I would love to ask people. If I find out that my father is a thief, should I respect my father or not?
Yeah, that's a good one.
That brings out, you know, the contradictions that we live with. Huh? So we have a society where certain things get a lot of emphasis, and we are perhaps one of the few societies where it is considered, you know, the word philosopher is an abuse word.
That's so true.
You're behaving like a philosopher. You know, if people say don't overthink. That's also a concept, overthink. Don't overcritical think, I suppose, is what they should say. So in this situation, then, how are we, you know, going to make the transition where thinking is considered almost an undesirable activity? Not that you're not able to think, but it is not considered all right. You're acting smart if you think for yourself. So I've been using this phrase, herd immunity from thinking.
Everyone is thinking the same way.
So we need to, yes, education has to have a strong role to play, but it can happen only if also this is happening in society. It's happening within institutions. So, for example, if in a meeting of education officers, the senior most officer who's conducting the meeting, if he says, I have made a statement, but there was a mistake in it, please find out what my mistake was. That is when we will start seeing a change happening, because currently what is happening is we never engage in looking at the merits of any statement or argument or any conclusion. We look at who is saying it. Where is it written? See, even when there's an argument, somebody says, where is it written that this is happening? This should happen. So the argument is not on what is the logical reason for saying this, or what is the data, what is the evidence. Huh? So there's a concept of truth conditions. What makes something true? In our context, something is true because of who has said it, where it is written, and what the authority of the person making the statement is. So to move away from that to critical thinking, including inside the classroom, where the teacher is so much older, bigger, more powerful than children, that is a challenge. And teachers will do it if their superior officers, so-called superior officers, start doing it with them. So this is one of those things which has to happen in the system first and then inside the classroom. So that's the way I would approach it.
Okay, so sir, if I can summarize it for myself, so basically for the digital divide, like what we talked is like to overcome those challenges, it's basically to stick to our roots. That is the general pedagogical principles of making it more engaging, having it more collaborative, giving the children the chance to have the technology on their own context, using it according to what they have their existing knowledge to it. And also to be like, for the critical thinking is basically we just have to change as a society, and we'll have to be more adaptive to others' opinions, and we'll have to give chance to people to basically think and speak their minds and to be non-judgmental about it.
Yeah, so, you know, the thing is, every time there's a new technology, the notion is the world is going to change. When books came about, it was thought inequality will go away because everybody will have books. Earlier, when they were handwritten, only a few people had them.
Yeah.
When radio came about, everybody thought the world is going to change. That radio, in fact, when radio was initiated, there were articles written saying this is the end of the school.
Yes, yes.
Similarly, when TV came, again, it was thought this is the end of school. India actually set up a program, INSAT TV and so on, hoping that it could make a dent. And when the internet came about, again, this was the case. Now, when the mobile phone is everywhere, again, this is the case. So what is it that, you know, though technology comes and though there is a movement, there is a shift, but what happens again and again is that those who were powerful become even more powerful. Those who were deprived don't become as powerful. So the problem is not in the technology, but in something else. It is the mindset issues. It's in how we use it. If we are not even conceptualizing it. For example, why is it that when we think of education technology, we always think only of a smartphone? Which is why I gave you that with a basic feature phone, I can do many, many things which will be far more engaging than what is being done with smartphones right now. Even with a voice recorded message, I can do a lot of things.
That's absolutely true, yeah.
It's a mindset issue. It is not a technology issue.
Thank you, sir. I'll move on to my next question. Is basically, it is to do with the organizations who are working in the domain of teacher capacity building. How should they adopt the NEP? And are there any aspects which need to change concerning the teacher capacity building interventions commonly planned these days?
Yeah, so this will need a lot more considered reply, but a few things that I can mention at this time. It's important to know that in its earlier part itself, the NEP talks very strongly of addressing diversity and focusing on marginalized children. Now, that has some very serious implications. So diversity, it's like this, that, and why it talks about this, there's a long history to it and how it is different from the earlier policy. Earlier policies talk definitely about reaching the benefit of education to those who are deprived. But it did not look upon diversity as such a major issue because at that time, maybe 40% children approximately used to be in school when the 1986 policy came out. But since then, what happened was that in a short period of about 20 years, almost all the children are in school. Now, these are children from groups who never used to go to school. Mm-hmm. So you have children with disabilities, for example, working children, migrant groups, children from certain communities, girls from certain communities, etc. So what happened was that we always had just diversity. Now we have super diversity. And in addition to this, we had very rapid urbanization and migration. So in a city like Jaipur or Delhi, you will have 10 languages in a slum area because of migration. And these will be languages like Punjabi and Odia next to each other, which are not otherwise contiguous in real life. So how do you teach in a situation like that is not a very well-known thing, teaching in a situation of diversity. So which is the reason why the NEP gives a lot of emphasis on flexibility of approach. It repeatedly talks about adapting to the learners and their requirements. It is also another reason why in building on what has been done in India on activity-based learning, constructivism, it talks a lot about experiential learning. So it talks about bringing in these experiences, reflecting on them, analyzing them, and coming to an understanding. So one is for any NGO or any organization working, the big issue is going to be to re-examine and align the pedagogical processes. from a more generic to a slightly more differentiated approach within the classroom to address diverse needs of a flexible group of children who are also not the same all the time. So getting your pedagogical model right is the big thing, I would say. Second thing is that the NEP talks a lot about moving towards standards of performance. Yes. So, you know, India from 2006, we began with ADEPS, the whole push towards defining performance standards and indicators for teachers. So now the NEP enshrines it with saying that this will be taken further and there'll be, you know, a whole organization looking at it, so on. So, you know, measuring performance is absolutely critical. So how it is to be read is like this, that there are three levels. One is what I will call just plain competence, which is what a person knows and what a person has a potential to do. So if any organization is working with teachers in particular, if you're increasing their knowledge, you're increasing their competence. Competence is not equal to what a person actually does. What a person does is performance, and performance happens well if competence is accompanied by certain enabling conditions. So, for example, if a teacher wants to teach something, there is sufficient space, there is equipment, there is material, there is enough time, and so on, then only teachers can actually do it. So there is a minimum set of conditions within which performance can take place. So if you want to measure performance, first create the conditions for the performance. Then you have to have an appropriate and objective way to assess performance. So when I say objective, simply a kind of Likert scale, 1, 2, 3, 4 is not enough. You have to have commonly acceptable descriptors, which different people looking at some teacher teaching will all agree teacher is at a particular level of performance. So creating performance standards and indicators is an important thing. Measuring it is an important thing. And of course, using data to measure, analyze, having real-time data is another critical thing to go. So performance assessment goes in. Now, if teachers perform well, it leads to something else, which is what we call effectiveness, which is to say, what is the result of the teacher's work in terms of students' learning equal to or commensurate with the input made by the teacher. So teacher may be teaching very well, but suppose teacher does not get academic support on time from CRC, BRC, or teacher does not get, children are not supported at home. The result that children show will not be equal to the input made by the teacher. So there are certain supportive conditions that are required for teachers' performance to actually result in student learning of the expected level. So any organization that is working has to understand competence, enabling conditions, performance, supportive conditions, and effectiveness. And lastly, in this bit, keeping track of student learning is extremely important, but mostly organizations have been looking at what I will call basic or low level learning objectives. Can a child read aloud? Can a child of class 5 read a class 3 textbook? That is a ridiculous way to assess learning. You have to look at things like, can a child form an opinion on the text read and give a reason for that opinion? The higher order learning that NEP talks about, which includes critical thinking, but also a higher order aspect. Can you take a decision in daily life using the mathematics that you know? So any organization that is using NEP as a basis has to align itself with higher order learning objectives to have a learning path of all the students, whichever way you're using to get there, to know the stages of getting there, to track that, to connect teacher learning, teacher performance with that, and also to use technology to enable both children and teachers to move towards those higher order learning. That's the shift that I would expect NEP to make to the work of all these organizations. It's very important to go beyond the low-hanging fruit.
That's very rightly put, sir. Like, all of, like, from my previous experiences, like, with different fellowships and all, in different geographies, And being a teacher myself as well for like 2 to 3 years, I have always realized that that is the first natural thought which comes to mind when it comes to the assessments is basically what is there that I can actually assess in a very quick manner and which will basically give it the results which are desired and not going to the, as you said, like the for the higher orders. So yeah, like the shift has to be changed to the HOs then the LOs.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So just a follow-up question to that is like, as you said, like in this year's, like the NEP 2020 law talks a lot about different sorts of assessments at different levels. Especially for this year, how do you think the assessments will have to play a role in the academics?
Right. So, you know, the thing about assessment always is to know what you're doing it for. What is the reason for doing it? So if the intention is to do assessment to know how well the system responds, the health of the system, so to say, then we already know that there is not much point in doing that assessment because we haven't taught anything and what is there to assess in that sense. I would therefore not assess children so much. I would assess what is the current level of teachers' own understanding, teachers' own plans for what to do when children come back, and our own organizational plans. I would have a whole lot of checklists to see. For instance, everybody knows that there has to be a lot of hygiene when schools are reopened, but hygiene costs money. So have we got in place what the sources are, and is that a practical thing, or are we only expecting community to chip in? So one is to know what exactly you are trying to assess. The other is, there's not much point in assessing anything if you do not let children know that you're going to be assessing something. So if I were to say that I would like to know that whether you can plan what you will do if you are given 2 hours, because nowadays every day you have 2 hours to yourself. So I want to know that. Then what I'm doing is I'm communicating to children that I value that they can, I value their ability to plan their own time and to make use of it. On the other hand, if I say I'm going to assess you on this chapter, then they will want to read that chapter. So since we are not making teaching learning of the regular kind happen, it's important for us to know, create what I will call a COVID curriculum. A COVID curriculum is what are the things which our children naturally picking up along the way. And I will give a, for instance, I will say, give a series of statements and say, which of the following is not true? You know, like I will say that keeping your hands clean can improve your health. Keeping your hands clean may lead to more expenditure. Keeping your hands clean will improve your handwriting. And I will give a, and I say, which is not true. So first I have to have a COVID curriculum in place, then I can do a COVID time assessment. If I don't have a COVID curriculum, I have no business to go around doing assessment at all. It's quite pointless to do. At the most, what it will show me is that learning levels have fallen. I mean, thank you. We already know that is going to be the case. And at the same time, I will not know where to begin because every place is going to be different. When we reopen, it will not happen that there will be a uniform reopening. There will be areas under lockdown. There will not be areas under lockdown. There will be areas where it's not under lockdown, but commuting is not possible. There'll be areas which is not under lockdown, but some children have to come from lockdown into that area. They can't come. Some children can come. So for us to think that there is going to be a uniform situation, therefore you can do some kind of assessment on some scale, that's not a really great idea. So I would say one, that let us use this as a learning opportunity for all children. Very quickly put together what I'm calling a COVID curriculum. And then do an assessment around that and use that data to build upon things when children come back. There'll be, you know, so many different new words. For example, there are so many words that children are learning, which are longer words. Temperature, for example. That's the word which a lot of children are picking up. Huh. So, what do you call that? Thermal meter. Huh. So, how can I build sensor? So, how can I build children's learning using those experiences is what I have to look at. So assessment is always possible when you have done your part. If you have not done your part, don't assess. In order to do your part, don't think what you were doing earlier is going to continue. It's not going to continue. But on the other hand, something is already on the ground. It is happening. Can you capitalize on it? And actually, we can come out with quite a brilliant COVID curriculum and enable children to learn a lot of things which otherwise they would not have learned.
Thank you, sir. This brings to the last question, which I want to ask you, is what are some of the key highlights you notice in the NEP which will influence the ecosystem in short and medium terms?
Here, the entire emphasis on the early years, both in ECE as well as in foundational learning, that is going to be that will play a role. I'm not going to say it's a game changer because, the game can refuse to change. But it has a lot of potential. We have always seen a lot of these game changers come and go. But so this is very valuable because there has been ICDS, but it has been not sufficiently focused on the cognitive, social, emotional development side. So that is one thing which will make a very strong difference. Flexibility in approach will make a difference. The whole emphasis on teachers, teacher preparation, teacher capability, teacher standards, that's another thing which should have a serious big impact. There is also this whole issue of assessment and setting up taking further the testing agency approach.
Hello.
So the caveats include things like, are we assessing the right things? Are we assessing in the right way? Are we using assessment to improve teaching or to just give feedback to children or to rank children? So a lot of things depend on that. But if it is utilized well, the entire emphasis on assessment can play a very big role as well. I would like to see a lot more of institutional development part that I am not sure how strongly it is present at the moment. But these are some of the more important areas which could make a difference.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering that question and for the overall laying out of your thoughts on the questions which I had today. Great.